So this is the Bryony Victoria. Shortly before she sank off Ringstead Bay, roughly 2 kilometres off the coast at around 4 p.m. on Monday before the cruise. So whilst I share things here on this screen, footage relayed live to the world from 5 cameras mounted on her. And so this is how it cycled through those 5 cameras. So that will run, and I'll be showing you things on this screen. So Fathom 1 is to Fathom. So Fathom is a unit of length, and it was originally based upon the width between your fingertips, and in theory that's 6 foot, the imperial fathom. And the name in Old English is fathom, meaning embracing arms. And somehow the fathom is used to measure the distance to another realm. On land we're buried at 1 fathom, 6 feet. And for burial at sea, you have to have at least 6 fathoms of water. And so the Bryony Victoria lies at 13 fathoms, roughly 25 metres deep, embraced by the outstretched arms of the ocean floor. So the boat took about 40 minutes to take on enough water to finally get to the point where the scuppers reached the level of the ocean surface. And then, at that moment, everything changed pace. And in a matter of seconds, the ship rolled over and disappeared beneath the surface. And it was a very strange moment that has just happened there. How can 32 tons of ship slip through that reflecting surface and disappear from human eyes? It seemed like a sort of a conjuring trick. And it sort of reinforced how that kind of shivering, reflecting surface is this boundary to another place. I think our fear and fascination with deep water is mostly to do with that unknowability, that mystery of what lies in that space that we can't be. It's a place that we're not made to be able to live. So that brings us to fear and fascination. That should be Fathom 2. Philip Hoare, in his book Leviathan or the Whale, it's a book that sort of really eloquently lays out his passion and obsession with whales, but he starts the book from his kind of childhood point of view of the deep, and his kind of horror and revulsion. He says, "I've always been afraid of deep water. Childish fears and fascinations, ready to emerge out of the depths like the giant squid in the film 20 Leagues Under the Sea. And in my children's encyclopedia, I read about the pressurized bathysphere, an island-like cell in which men descended into the Marianas Trench, where translucent anglerfish lured their prey with luminous growths suspended in front of their gaping and devilish jaws. I was so scared of these monsters that I couldn't even touch the pages on which the pictures were printed, and had to turn them by their corners." And another book of whales and monstrous seas, of course, is Moby Dick. And towards the beginning of Melville's novel, a preacher gives a sermon about the plight of Jonah. So he says, "As we have seen, God came upon him in the whale and swallowed him down to the living gulfs of doom, and with swift slantings tore him along into the midst of the seas, where the eddying depths sucked him 10,000 fathoms down, and the weeds were wrapped around his head, and all the watery world of woe bowled over him. Yet even then, beyond the reach of any plummet, out of the belly of hell, when the whale grounded upon the ocean's utmost bones, even then God heard the engulfed, repenting prophet when he cried. Then God spake unto the fish, and from the shuddering cold and blackness of the sea, the whale came reaching up towards the warm and pleasant sun, and all the delights of the air and earth, and vomited Jonah upon the dry land." And so, both Hoare and Melville seem to be, at the same time, horrified, but also fascinated and attracted to this other place. And I think particularly by its alien dimensions and its kind of unknowability. So Fathom 3, a taxonomy of sea monsters. So those fears seem to be run throughout the whole of history. This is Carta Marina, drawn by Olaus Magnus in 1539. And at the time it was the largest and most detailed and accurate map of Europe. So he gathered all the information that he could about these lands, but also as much as he could known facts about the sea, gathered from sailors and fishermen. And of course, the facts of that sea included the sea monsters that you would meet, that are very carefully laid out with notes at the side of the map. So this is the sea orm. The sea orm is over 200 foot long and more than 20 feet thick, and it can destroy ships, but it's also it can be a sign of wonderful change of the kingdom near at hand. Then there's the Prista, this creature here. This is described as very cruel, a kind of whale that can sink a ship just by surfacing from the water. And then there's also the Rochus down here. And these are actually a kind of benevolent monster, a kind of ray. And they protect swimming man and save him from being devoured by other sea monsters. But there's hundreds of different monsters in various maps, and lots of the accounts overlap. So, for instance, there's many monsters that seem to disguise themselves as rocks or islands, and they tempt sailors to land on them before disappearing again. So this is St. Brendan, Irish folklore, and he encounters this monster called the Jasconius. And again, Brendan was tempted to land, and then what seemed to be an island suddenly disappears beneath the waves. And in Icelandic myths, there's basically the same story with a creature called the Hafbuffa, found off the coast of Greenland. And yet another is the Asfistogluna, sometimes described as a large whale, sometimes a kind of turtle. But always these things have a kind of huge form with rocky crevices and valleys, and sometimes even trees and greenery and sand dunes. And the poor sailors longing for land drop anchor, come ashore, and then the monster disappears under the waves and drags them down into the depths. Another kind of monster is the kraken, found off the coast of Norway and Greenland. And the kraken seems to be like a giant squid or octopus, and possibly from sightings of real giant squid. So all of these creatures seem to appear when particular circumstances. The name Hafgufa in Icelandic combines haf meaning sea and gufa meaning steam or mist. And the Hafgufa or kraken usually appear in thick fog, particularly around Iceland. And other signs that they might be coming is sudden bubbles of water, or dangerous currents, or the appearance of new islands, and foul stenches. And the kraken is said to generate these awful smells, like rotting fish coming from the kraken's stomach. And with all of these traits, you can sort of see how they could be confused or kind of come from volcanic activity. So Fathom 4, Angry Mountains. So the Atlantic is gradually widening, pulling itself apart along the mid-Atlantic ridge. And all the little dots of land that are within this enormous ocean are basically undersea volcanoes. So you've got the Cap Verdes, the Canary Islands, the Azores, and right at the top, Iceland. And so the sailors crossing these treacherous waters, kind of longing for the security of land, actually find totally untrustworthy land. So this is the birth of a new island, a kind of terrifying kraken or Hafgufa, appearing in explosions of steam and bubbles, and then in this case disappearing again beneath the waves 2 days later. Fathom 5, Drowned Worlds. So as well as having to cross bodies of water or step into bodies of water, there's also a kind of fundamental fear that we have of the usually tame waters rising to place in floods or tidal waves. So this is from the recent flood in New Orleans, when the levees finally broke. And another one from that. And then this is the tsunami recently in Japan. But both of these floods are tiny compared to one that might still be in our collective memory. This is an image of the Gibraltar Straits seen from the space station. So this is Africa, this is Spain, and this is the Atlantic Ocean. And 5 million years ago, there was a land bridge across here. But eventually that land bridge failed, and there was this event called the Zambian Flood. So when that bridge broke, so at that point the Mediterranean was a depression in the earth, a dry savanna covered with animals and trees. But eventually this bridge broke, and the Atlantic Ocean cascaded down a 10-kilometer drop and filled the entire Mediterranean in, they think, about 40 years.
10 kilometers? Difference in water level?
Well, there was no water then. It was a dry depression. So the water of the Atlantic fell down this dry slope and filled the water until it was the same level. And so they found fossils on Malta and Sicily and Cyprus of dwarf hippopotami, And these creatures survived on the little bits of dry land that were left, and gradually over the millennia, through evolution, became smaller and smaller, and then died out relatively recently. So you can imagine that the hippopotamuses that happened to be left on these bits of high land being cut off and having a different evolution from the hippopotami in Africa. J.G. Ballard, in his book Drowned World, is maybe one of the first to articulate this ecological fear of rising waters. And this is the planetarium on Euston Road. And you discover right at the end of Drowned World that the whole book has actually been taking place above London. And so this is a description. He's in a boat about here, and he's diving. He took his feet off the rungs and let his weight carry him slowly downwards into the green-lit deep, hand over hand along the rail, and paused at the 2-fathom mark. So 2 fathoms would be somewhere there, I guess. 40 foot away from him loomed the pale curved hull of the planetarium, far larger and more mysterious than it seemed from the surface, like the stern of an ancient sunken liner. The once polished aluminium roof had become dull and blunted, mollusks and bivalves clinging to the narrow edges formed by the transverse vaulting. 20 feet from the bottom, the ladder ended. He let himself sink downwards until he was holding the tips of the ladder above his head with his fingers, then released them and glided away backwards towards the lake floor. He sank to his knees in the soft loam which covered the floor and steadied himself against a barnacled lamppost. So I guess that might be that lamppost there. In a relaxed and graceful moon stride, he loped through the deep sludge, which rose from his footprints like clouds of disturbed gas. On his right were the dim flanks of the buildings lining the sidewalk, the silt piled in soft dunes up to their first floor windows. Fathom 6, Asphyxiated Seas. So another way to know the landscape at the bottom of the sea is to remove the water. This is an image from the Aral Sea. And again from space, this is how it was 2 decades ago. No, actually it's probably more now. In the early 1960s, the Soviet government decided to divert 2 rivers that fed the Aral Sea to irrigate the desert in an attempt to grow white gold or cotton. And they temporarily succeeded. And in 1988, Uzbekistan was the world's largest exporter of cotton. But what was one of the world's largest inland seas began to shrink. And so this is the Aral Sea today. And that was the perimeter there. And these are photos from the new desert created from what was the sea floor. And these abandoned boats, you have to kind of imagine gradually sinking with the water level until they rested on the bottom of this sea. And they're called kind of ships of the desert.
And sorry, when did this dry up?
Where?
When?
When? It's still drying out. So this slide is now. So it's still got a little bit of drying out to do. But it's every year shrinking more and more. And the rivers were diverted in the early 60s. so it's been drying out since they were diverted.
And it's expected that that remaining water will dry.
Yeah. The lowest point on the Earth's crust, the lowest point that is above water, is the Dead Sea in Israel. And that's geologically a depression in the Earth. But also water's been diverted, and it's now, the sea level is the water level is sinking further, 1 meter a year, I think. So currently, this surface of the salty Dead Sea is 418 meters below sea level, so almost half a kilometer. And when you stand by the waters, obviously this could be projection because you know that you're half a kilometer below sea level, but the air feels strangely loopy. You are at a different pressure, much more pressure than you did before. And this was a proposal I made to envisage this missing ocean. To build or to have built a special mortar shell firework, the kind of that you get off the Sydney Harbour Bridge, but one that would be constructed so that it went exactly 418 metres high and then exploded in a blue surface of fire to describe this missing ocean. Fathom 7, inverted map. So, in all this uncertainty and confusion of waters rising and seas drying up and tectonic plates shifting, I designed a map where the land and the sea was inverted. So, what was the British Isles become this inland sea, connected to the Caucasian Ocean by a small channel, and the Black Sea becomes this isthmus of land, black land, connected to South Mediterranean. Fathom 8, the deeps of the mind. These fears and fascination with water often seem to be used as a metaphor for the mind itself. Freud seemed to think of the subconscious mind as a body of deep water within which things stirred. He often talks about how memories auftauchen, in German means to emerge or to surface, as if they're rising from a great depth. And a metaphor that's often used to describe his theories of the mind is an iceberg. So for Freud, conscious thoughts were only the tiny 10% of the mind that is above the water. And the rest is made up of the ego, the superego, and the bit that is totally under the water, the id. Freud says that the object of psychoanalytic technique is to strengthen the ego, to make it more independent of the superego, to widen its field of vision, and so to extend its organization so that it can take over new portions of the id. Where it was, there shall ego be. And he concludes that thought with its reclamation work, like the draining of the Zuidas Zee. So it's sort of like a banishing or a controlling of these deep waters. Oops, sorry. My favourite mind sea metaphor is Stanislav Lem's sci-fi masterpiece Solaris, which this is one of the original covers. The story is told from the point of view of a scientist who is newly arrived at a space station that is floating above a liquid planet, an ocean planet. And this this space station is a kind of scientist's research station where they've been studying this planet for years. And they've come to believe that the waters of this ocean planet are actually a huge sentient mind. And the blind empathy of this mind tortures the visitors by manifesting their repressed desires and dreams and urges in the form of strange ghosts and simulations. And these scientists are gradually being driven mad by accessing their subconscious through this world. Stanislav Lem writes, "Alone over the ocean, I saw it with a different eye. I was flying quite low, at about 100 feet, and for the first time, I saw a sensation often described by the explorers, but which I'd never noticed from the height of the station. The alternating motion of the gleaming waves was not at all like the undulation of the sea or the billowing clouds. It was like the crawling skin of an animal, the incessant slow motion contractions of muscular flesh secreting a crimson foam. I sat on the rough fissure beach. A heavy black wave broke over the edge of the bank and spread out, not black but a dirty green. The ebbing wave left viscous streamlets behind, which flowed back quivering towards the ocean. I went closer, and when the next wave came, I held out my hand. The wave hesitated, recoiled, then enveloped my hand without touching it, so that a thin covering of air separated my glove inside a cavity, which had been fluid a moment previously, and now had a fleshy consistency." Pattern 9, the aquatic ape. But as well as all this fear and dread of the ocean deep, there's also this opposite impulse. We seem to be almost magnetically attracted to water. And even though we have these fears, we overcome them. And one theory that attempts to explain this is the aquatic ape hypothesis. This was first proposed by a German pathologist and then later by an English marine biologist, Alistair Hardy, in 1960. In the 70s, it was taken up by Elaine Morgan and Desmond Morris. And the theory uses various odd attributes of the human body to suggest that actually maybe we evolved from a semi-aquatic animal, something like a hippo that spends a lot of its time in water. One of the proofs is our hairlessness. Like seals or dolphins, we are hairless mammals. And in our case, except for the head, which would normally have been left out of water. Another is bipedalism, walking on two legs, which is a totally unique posture amongst the mammals. And this theory suggests that maybe that could have come from wading in deeper waters and gradually assuming that posture. Another is conscious control of breathing. We're one of the only mammals, land mammals, that does that. Other mammals, it's a totally automatic reflex. Another is our babies are covered in this cheesy varnish that's only seen in species of seal, apparently. And the human kidneys are much, much better at excreting salt than most land mammals. And yet another is our habitat. All over the world, people seem to cluster around water and indeed throw themselves into it or perform religious ceremonies. And so these are just some random images from around the world. And I mean, there are many proofs. Another one is the way our skin wrinkles. It was assumed that that was just the swelling of the skin, but apparently it's actually caused by an unconscious automatic the automatic response within the nervous system that pulls the skin together. And it's this theory wonders whether that's actually to help hold things underwater. It has to be said that this theory is also widely ridiculed by other scientists. So it's very contentious. But I think it's trying to explain our special relationship with water. Fathom 10, a walk through a landscape at the bottom of the sea. So I guess this video is my attempt to manifest this urge and attraction to wonder what it would be like to live under the waves. Fathom 10, utopicity. So I'm not alone in this desire and quest. Many people have shared the urge to be able to live underwater. And there's many utopian plans for underwater cities. This is a model for a city designed by Buckminster Fuller, the American architect and dreamer. The city is called Triton. And it would be a floating mobile city that could be anchored anywhere in the world's oceans. But he also went one further to draw up plans for an underwater city. This is built around a kind of central shaft that would be an oil drilling platform. But the inhabitants would live underwater in this section. And have elevators that could take them up to the surface where materials would be transferred from boats or down to submarine docking sections. And this is another utopian architecture practice, the British group Archigram, This is a photo of a crucicle. It's a jellyfish-like invention that inflated from a backpack so that wherever the wearer was, they had this environment that they could be cushioned within. And this is their design for an underwater city, which is rather unfathomable itself. Fathom 11 Skylab under the sea. NASA attempted to actually build not a city, but in a way a sort of like a space station, but underwater. And this is their Tektite project. And in 1969, this was submerged beneath the waves and provided a habitat for divers to live in. So temporarily, it enabled people to stay under the ocean. So for centuries before this, people have been using crude artificial breathing systems, pumps, sending air down pipes. But the problem is that diving deeper, gases in the body's cavities get compressed as you go underwater, and then as you start to come up again, they expand to many times the size. So they can sort of rip open various bits of you if you don't very carefully control it. But an even bigger problem is that the gases that are super saturated in your blood, as you move into lower pressures, come out of solution and form bubbles. And then when those bubbles reach your lungs or your brain, you have an embolism or a stroke and excruciating pain. The point of these kind of habitats, and the way that you avoid those is that you have to pause at levels when you come up so that your body has time to adjust. But the problem being that the deeper you go, the longer those pauses are and the less time it leaves you to actually do anything down there. And so these habitats solve that by not having to come up. So your body stays at this super saturated state. And so you can live and work coming in and out by sort of entering this little pool and emerging out into the space and then coming back in again, but the whole time being at this pressure.
And then finally, these are real things.
This is real, yeah.
Because some of what you showed us wasn't.
No, this is true. These are NASA's photographs from Tektite. Actually, everything I've shown is real. Apart from the sea monsters, but they were thought to be real. This is Sylvia Earle on the right, the team leader of one of the Tektite missions. And she was a marine biologist and explorer. And unique amongst NASA missions, she recruited and led an all-woman crew. So this mission created an absolute media storm, partly because they seemed to always be wearing bikinis in their photo shoots. And they were dubbed by the press as aquanets. This is them relaxing in Tektite. And in fact, NASA had to call a halt to press interviews because they were being prevented from actually doing any science. One article in the New Yorker referred to Earle as her deepness. And Earle is quite an amazing figure with many records and many firsts. This is in 1979. Earl walked untethered on the seafloor at the lowest depth that any living human being had been. then or since. This suit is called the gym suit. She was taken 1,250 feet or 208 fathoms below the ocean surface. And at the bottom, she was detached from the vessel and spent 2.5 hours exploring the landscape, only connected to the submarine by a communications cable and not connected to the world above at all. But also notice, suspended from the arm of the suit, the flag, which brings us to Fathom 12, owning the deep. So as with Africa, South America, Antarctica, the race to explore and map new landscapes always seems to combine science's thirst for knowledge with political thirst for territory. And this is no different to the ocean depths. This is Artur Chilingarov with a Russian flag and the Arctic Ocean map. And in 2007, he launched 2 submersibles and led a mission to the Lomonosov Ridge. And the point of this was not just further science, or in fact, really furthering science was red herring. The United Nations Conventions of the Law of the Sea, Article 3, says the breadth of the territorial sea is 12 nautical miles. So any land 12 nautical miles out belong to that country. But this section says the continental margin comprises the submerged prolongation of the landmass of coastal state and consists of seabed and subsoil of the shelf, slope and rise. It does not include the deep ocean floor with its ocean ridges and subsoil thereof. So basically what that means is that the trick to claiming much bigger chunks of land is to prove that an underwater feature is an extension of the continental shelf that comes from your country. So for Russia, that might be the Lomonosov Ridge. And so the purpose of this mission was to validate that claim. So these are the submarines underneath the North Pole. And this is the moment that the robotic arm places a titanium sphere with a Russian flag on top in the silt and eternal night of the Arctic Ocean. And this is afterwards with a photograph of the flag coming back from that mission. And finally, Fathom 13, the Briony Victoria. So this was my own attempt at sending something into this other realm. The Briony Victoria lies a few kilometres off the Dorset coast and 25 metres beneath the surface of the sea. And she's crossed into this other world. She's left our timescale of missed appointments, plans for the future, diary entries, and entered a sort of geological time. And she started the slow metamorphosis from a defunct vessel, something that belongs to our world, and begun this hundreds of years process of slowly becoming an artificial reef. So that's sort of an end, but there's just one little epilogue. After she sank, about a month later I dived, and this is a photograph of me in the bridge of the Briony Victoria. And I think that is it. The information for this talk is slightly out of date. The cameras transmitted live from the sinking and the journey going down to the ocean floor, and then stayed transmitting for 6 days, and we lost the live feed after 6 days. And there was a small technical reason. There was the power rating of cameras, or a setting that the cameras were left on, meant that they worked all day and they should have just been for 8 hours a day. So the solar panels couldn't provide enough power, and after 6 days that balance was lost. But when we went to dive to reinstate, it should have been a very simple thing, we discovered a much bigger problem, which is that the umbilical cables are cut. So we don't know what has done that, something very sharp. So it doesn't seem like we're going to be able to reinstate it. But that doesn't mean that there won't be more news back from it. It's being dived very regularly. The first bank holiday weekend, there were 7 dive boats that visited it with boatloads of divers. So we're going to use them as a kind of crowdsourcing. And I want to visit it on August the 4th every year, I think. But, you know, it's going to be there permanently. And it's absolutely going to outlive me, and who knows what else it might outlive. So it's starting a process of transformation that is in a different time scale. It's going to be there for hundreds and hundreds of years. Everything that I said, it might seem unbelievable, but as far as I can tell, these are genuine theories. The Zambian flood is something that's proposed, and the aquatic ape, as I said, is very contentious and ridiculed by a lot of people. But it, for instance, appears in Desmond Morris's Naked Egg. Yeah.
I was just interested in the female divers, the scientists.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing something a little while ago about some Japanese divers for pearls, also female. And then obviously ships are always female. So I just wondered, it was more sort of curiosity, if you'd thought of that or what.
And I think that's why Earl is a really interesting character, because light, space, sea is traditionally a male space, which is why it's shaped female, I think. So, yeah, I don't know. You're right, but I think somehow the sea and ships seem female to me. I haven't really thought about it. I think I'm in deep water, actually.
Maybe it's something to do with sort of wet and warm. Violent. Maybe a bit difficult to figure out, which is very sexist of me to say.
When you read Solaris, that seems to be in Sansa Valen's mind, I think. Yeah.
Simon, you you said a boat, that you made that boat, so that is almost part of you. Do you feel like it's like a part of you down there, or is it an object that you have detached from now that is sunk?
I bought the remnants of a boat called Bride Victoria. So it was kind of important to me that boat was someone's boat, and it had been sitting in that boatyard for years and years and years, and the owner had long since died. So that was important, that it was someone was connected to that thing, it was their habitat. But yes, you're right, it had lost its wheelhouse, so we had to reinstate a wheelhouse. So the design for the wheelhouse is my design, working from lots of other boats. When we dived, the visibility was terrible, and I'm not an experienced diver at all. I learned to dive to make that walking underwater piece, and I hadn't dived since. But the other divers I could see were very disorientated, and I was disoriented when I first got to it because I couldn't quite work out which bit I got to, but then I immediately knew where everything was. And so that image, I think I didn't expect to use that within the exhibition, but somehow it seemed to be a sort of projection of, yeah, the kind of the phantom of the owner of that ship still in the bridge. It was a shock seeing that. But no, I felt reunited.
Who took the picture?
It was one of those things where I was just very lucky. The dive boat that was going out, a bunch of other divers used the opportunity to also visit the ship. And there's he's writing a book on the wrecks off the Dorset coast, and so he's a very experienced underwater photographer, and he was diving with his dive buddy who had a good torch. So there's one diver shining a torch towards me, and he's here, and I had done a refresher course the day before because I hadn't dived since I'd done that walking piece. And in the refresher course, you have to do these exercises where you take off your mask and fill it up with air and put it back on again, and take out your regulator and put it back in again. And so that was very fresh in my mind. It just occurred to me that I could do it. And so we discussed on the boat going out doing that. And the other divers were kind of really quite freaked out that I was prepared to do that, but actually I think it's because I'm much more novice and therefore I'd only just done it the day before. But then the idea of taking the mask up underwater, which you can't see anything, was kind of a terrifying thing.
So it's not the first deep water selfie then? it's quite a strange image. Were you surprised by it?
I was really surprised by it. I mean, basically, I think I look dead, which is quite a surprising view of yourself to have. I think it's something that you never see, because of course divers don't take their mask off for good reasons. And there's something very strange that happens to the skin, where it's swollen but also compressed at the same time.
Tell me more about the walking underwater one.
Sure.
That's quite strange and shocking as well.
Yeah, I mean that was attempting in a way to visualise something that maybe we are able to do in our dreams, where we can fly or we can walk underwater. So to realise that, there's obviously a big sleight of hand. I've got a little half tank of air on my chest. I sewed. I sewed straps onto big lead weights with Velcro fastenings so they could be very quickly taken off. The white shirt covers all of the tubes and stuff coming from the half tank. I took off the strap from the goggles and replaced it with fishing line. So all of that to embody. I mean, the odd thing is that I have to put myself in that situation. I don't exactly know why, but I want to embody that experience and report back from it. Most people, I think, would first try using After Effects rather than diving to achieve that. But that's how I did it.
So you had a team of people that they taught you to dive, but someone obviously, again, someone with a camera there. Was there someone else, were there a few people with you, or just you?
It was just me and the curator who happened to be a diving nut. very experienced. I did a crash course in Berlin, four-day crash course, and then flew to Croatia, and I had a week residency, and I built a tripod. Because again, that's not something you normally do. You normally take your camera with you, but I wanted this kind of static shot. And we had a housing that I could put my camera into and press record at the surface and then take it down. And we tried all week, and we basically had four successful shots, which is fun.
Okay.